went down and the jungle fire was burning. Down the track came a hobo hiking, and he said, "Boys, I'm not turning. I'm headed for a land that's far away, beside the crystal fountains. So come with me, we'll go and see the Big Rock Candy Mountains. In the Big Rock Candy Mountains, there's a land that's fair and bright, where the handouts grow on bushes, and you sleep out every night. Where the boxcars all are empty, and the sun shines every day on the birds."
Take two.
Take two. We're finally doing it. Cool. Well, again, I appreciate you doing this, man. It's yeah. Very, very kind of you.
This is fun.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. So I guess, you know, the reason I want to talk to you specifically is that you've had this career where you've gone from, you know, being, you know, working in a corporate setting, you know, at a casino, and you worked at a bank for a while, right?
No, I never worked in a bank.
But you lived in a, I mean, you worked as a 9-to-5er, right?
Yeah, yeah. You can call it banker hours, but
right, right.
It almost felt like a bank because we have the casino cash, like,
right
in front of you. Feels like a bank, but it's not a bank.
Well, from what I understand is that you had this very stable job.
Yeah.
That, you know, you were making good money and you could have stayed at for the rest of your life and, you know, been pretty comfortable, but there was something about not wanting to be there that was, you know, you were, you found that there was something more meaningful than just making good money and, you know.
Just there?
Yeah, absolutely, right?
Good. I want to make sure you feel the same way, because that is the same question I often ask myself all the time.
Well, did you want to talk a little bit about your background in general? Or?
Yeah, so let's see where we want to start. If we're just talking about career, I guess I can look back and say, before I graduated from my accounting degree.
Yeah. Keep talking.
About two months before I graduated,
right,
I got this opportunity to start my career before I graduated.
Yeah.
So one day I went into the classroom and I saw there's a name and a phone number on there.
Right.
And it turned out that's our CFO's name and phone number.
Right.
So our professor, he grew up with the CFO who is down in Mesquite running the tri-property casinos. So he kind of called him up and then sent me down there. I got the job and just kind of started from there. I was there for 6 years.
Yeah.
Yeah, so basically it was a good job. It was fun, like working in casinos, running finance, figuring out a lot of strategy stuff. And most of the stuff I do, it's a bit more technical. Like I design and build a financial system there. So we're able to kind of really scrub expenses a lot and then help the company become a lot more profitable.
Right.
And that's kind of how I made my name there.
Right.
So it was fun, really fun. Like, I still miss it sometimes.
Right.
Just because the stuff you do there, it just kind of, it's always
crazy, right?
Yeah, it's always like special project, problem solving, things that nobody ever done before and they wanted to accomplish. Right. And you basically, I was lucky to have the freedom to do whatever I want.
Yeah.
Because it's kind of like open-ending question and they have no solution. And it's up to you to find a solution. That was just fun. Like, I love that. So that's kind of how I started my career, 6 years there. And then what really got me thinking about leaving was, I would say it was Lulu, you met her, my little one. When she was born, I started to think, like, what is the point of working here?
Right.
Like, basically, I just wake up in the morning, go to work, come home, go to sleep, wake up, go to work, come home, go to sleep.
Yeah.
Every single day.
Right.
And that's starting to become a drag. It doesn't matter how fun it is. It's starting to just kind of get to you and be like, wow, it looked like 6 years, and now here's a new baby.
Right.
And I miss the other two most of the time. Right. Even though I got a good life, good house, kids are having fun.
Yeah.
But I was never in the picture.
Right.
And then some things happened. For me to do my job well, some people would lose their job.
Right.
So I've been doing that, just kind of multiple things, right? Like there's employee theft, all kind of stuff.
Right.
And one instance, we caught this guy stealing from us.
Right.
And my kids play with his kids in the park.
Yeah.
So all of a sudden it just hit me, like, wait, what am I doing here? I'm putting my kid's friend's dad in jail.
Yeah.
Like, is that really what I want to do?
Right.
And the story is really sad because the reason why he's stealing money from us is because he's addicted to gambling. He's putting the money back to our table games.
Right.
So I just kind of look at that like, this makes, well, it makes sense.
Yeah.
Right, because we're doing a good job. Like,
right.
Right, yeah, people want to gamble and all that stuff. At the same time, it makes no sense.
Yeah, right.
Like, there's so many ways to make money.
Right.
Why did I choose? I didn't really choose that. We kind of fell in my lap. But
right.
If I have a choice, that's probably not what I want to do.
Right.
Right. So that's kind of where I lived. And then just from there, one thing after another. Did it stop?
Yeah, it stopped for a second. But we have audio.
Okay.
We have several audio channels.
So anyways, backtrack. So one thing after another. I moved up here, and then I met Bryan Mar Taylor. And long story short, we got talking, and there's this idea of having an online art school.
Yeah.
And before I even started the whole casino career, I moved here from Taiwan to do art.
Yeah.
Right, and then I got married, first kid, 2008. Nothing happened. Stopped doing art. Got my accounting degree,
right.
Casino thing happened. So I always loved art. I carried my easel, brushes, oils, canvases every time we move for 10 years.
Yeah.
And every time we move, my wife asked me, why do you still carry these things?
Right.
You're never gonna do anything with it. I keep saying, well, one day I'm gonna unpack it. I'm gonna start painting.
Right.
So I did. 2019, after I met Bryan, I got so inspired, I started painting every day.
Yeah.
Just kind of after work, I would do that. And then I just fell in love with art again.
Yeah.
So we decided to start Sentient Academy. So that's kind of the background and the story. And that, you know, blink of eyes is 2 years already.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So that's kind of the short version of this story.
Yeah, well, and I think it's, I mean, the thing that I'm trying to do by driving around the country and meeting people is to trying to discuss, like, you know, how do you choose something that's more difficult but potentially more meaningful over something that's safer, that's more comfortable? Because it's not an easy decision to make, you know, to choose drawing and painting, which is this very hard, difficult thing to do, and to, you know, to give up a, you know, well-paying, comfortable job to do that, right? Which, it sounds ridiculous, but, you know, I've been talking to a lot of people who've done stuff like this, and they feel better about themselves in general having made that decision than when they were, you know, making tons of money and living really well, but now they don't have that, they're still like, they feel totally, you know.
Yeah, I think a big question to ask is, how do you define getting paid really well, right?
Yeah,
like money,
right?
Or status, or power,
yeah,
or, and I kind of got all that in casinos, because,
right,
you know, I was untouchable. People give me what I want.
Yeah.
Feels great. It was really just kind of, especially in the casinos, right? There's a bit of, like, I don't know how to say it. It's just like cool factor.
Oh yeah.
Being in there, being in, you know, the handful of the decision makers, and the power is in your hand. You decide who lives, who dies. Or,
right.
But at the same time, there's nothing outside of that, like I didn't feel like I have a soul. I didn't really want to be involved with my kids.
Right.
You know, like stuff like that, it just really make you think and say, is this really what I want?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, and I don't know. The thing that I've been thinking a lot about is, how much time do we actually have to exist and do the things we want? Like, when you break down your life, it's like, you know, you're in school until you're essentially like 23 or 24, right? And then your career is 60 years, and then you die at 84, right? But, you know, it's like, that 60 years is your real life. The thing, that's where you're going to spend your time really figuring out who you are.
Yeah.
But then you cut that right down the middle because you're sleeping half the time, right?
Exactly.
And then there's also driving and, you know, all this other stuff. And, you know, it's like when you really look at how many months you have, right?
In your entire whole life.
Yeah, like, right? So 30 years is like how many months is that? Like 400 months or something?
I don't know.
You know? It's like, I mean.
Yeah.
But when you break it down that way, it's like you have 400 waking months to go and do something with your life, right?
Yeah.
And ultimately, it's like, you know, no matter how much money or power or anything that you have, that there's like a fundamental truth to existing that transcends having money, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And again, that's the thing I'm trying to look for, is like, what is more valuable to money? Because I ask everyone this question, is like, would you be doing exactly what you're doing right now if you had $1 billion? And when people say yes, they're admitting that there's stuff in their life that is literally priceless, because mm-hmm. they'd be doing it even if they had $1 billion.
I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing if I have $1 billion, just to be completely honest with you. It's just nonsense. Right. Why would you do that?
Well, what would you do?
For me, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, for me, like, personally, that wouldn't be my answer, because I know things will change.
Right.
My life will change. People around me will change.
Yeah.
I will change, just because I'm not talking about, you know, like, $1 billion, having the best of everything, like having 50 cars or whatever. Yeah. But fundamentally, when you have that kind of money, it will change you in so many different ways. For example, there are things that you want to do, like Sentient Academy, right? There's always people who feel like they can't afford the courses, no matter how affordable you make it.
Yeah.
And I always say, yeah, if I have that kind of money, I'll just get the best artists and teach, and I'll just offer the I'll pay them well, and then I'll offer the courses for free.
Yeah.
And I can't do that right now because I seriously don't have the money. I put in my own savings to start a school.
Right.
But if I have $1 billion, heck yeah, I would do that.
Right.
So I would, something will change in my life, right? Mm. Some things that I wish I could do right now, but I don't have the resource and ability to do, I would try to do those things. And of course, I'm not gonna be all like, oh, I would do all things charitable. I would take care of my family too, right? Like,
yeah, absolutely.
You know, like,
well, I guess part of it is like, you would still do Sentient Academy though, right? It's like,
yeah,
you know, again, $1 billion, like, fundamentally things would go quicker if you had $1 billion.
Sketchy van.
Yeah, sketchy van. What?
Oh yeah, that's part of the, yeah, I'll check it.
I have to get nicer stuff at some point.
Okay, well, we can kind of go and stop.
Oh yeah, well, I that's part of, I want to make it like kind of janky too.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like, I mean, I'm like,
I know, right?
But it's like a, like, you know, what you would do if you had $1 billion is you would make Sentient Academy go faster, right? But still, the fundamental of what you're trying to do is still the same, right?
That's just part of the things I would do, right? Because you need to think about this, right? So when I teach people about business, there's everything in the world, it's based on this concept of limited resources.
Right.
Because if we have unlimited resources,
right,
we'll do basically whatever we want, right?
Right.
But it's not possible, even with unlimited money.
Right.
Time is limited.
Yeah.
Right? So we always live under limited resources, meaning time and money.
Right.
So by changing one part of it, having $1 billion, I'm not gonna live longer.
Oh yeah.
So that means it's gonna force me,
right,
with the same, you know, logic, limited resources, now I have more money, but time is still the same.
Yeah.
That it's gonna make me want to do more things now, because I'm gonna try to stretch my time now, right?
Oh yeah.
Right? So instead of, you know, like, oh, right now I'm doing all Sentient Academy, that if I have that, I would do that and other things.
Right.
Because I'm gonna try to stretch my time out, because all of a sudden I have almost unlimited money.
Right.
I'm gonna do something to make my life seem longer. Because like earlier you said, you know, you spend half the time sleeping, all that stuff. We really have that much time, but with money, you could stretch your time. So something that I would do quite different, really fundamentally quite different.
Oh yeah,
you know?
Well, but it's like, if you have $1 billion, you know, a lot of people might think that they'll go and I'll retire to Hawaii and I'll just drink margaritas on the beach. But it's like,
to me, it's a waste of time.
Well, but it's like, how long do you do that for?
Right? Yeah, right? Like
2 weeks? If you're doing that for more than 6 months, you're an alcoholic, right?
Yeah.
And if you do it for a month.
If you do it for a year, you're probably going to be
dead soon.
Yeah, right. It's probably not a good idea.
And that's why I'm saying, why, like, with limited resources, your time being limited.
But the thing I believe, your time is always your most valuable asset.
Of course, like freedom of your time, control over your time. That's kind of what I'm after. Is with all the stuff I'm doing. I mean, you take a risk, right?
Yeah.
But the trade-off here is not money per se. It's the freedom.
Yeah, absolutely. That's what I'm kind of getting at. Is like you wouldn't necessarily accept $1 billion if it meant you gave up your autonomy, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's like you have to work 11 hours a day, no matter what, but you get $1 billion.
That is the condition. You did not say earlier.
No. Right. But I'm adding that.
Yeah, if you have a condition, say in order to get that, then you lose the freedom.
Right.
I don't think I'm gonna go for that.
Oh right. Yeah. Well, and it's, I think it's like a, you know, once you remove the need for resources, then it's like your values become like, oh, I, you know, it's not like you would go and stop Sentient Academy and go start like trying to be a famous guitarist or try and start an insurance company or try, you know, you wouldn't necessarily do those things. You would keep doing the things you're doing just at a larger scale, right?
Or I actually have a lot of other ideas that I would start. So,
well, no, but it's like it would be like, it wouldn't necessarily be like doing things you don't want to do that are more efficient.
Yeah, it's more like doing more things that I want to do.
Yeah.
At a scale and a speed that I could not afford before.
Right.
But
right.
I wouldn't just do all, because that's not how my brain operates. Like, if I only do one thing, it would drive me nuts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and I don't know. It's like the people that I've talked to, that, you know, $1 billion is obviously like a ridiculous amount of money.
And
I've met people with $1 billion or close to $1 billion. Mm-hmm. And talking to them, it's like, you know, a cheeseburger always tastes the same, no matter if you have $1 or $1 billion or whatever. You know, it's like, things don't get, like, riding a jet ski is awesome. It doesn't get better. You can ride a jet ski more often if you have $1 billion, I guess. You know, you can have a private jet, but it's like, there are diminishing returns on how much the money actually affects your day-to-day happiness, right? And it becomes about the projects that you do and the way you spend that money and the people that you help. And ultimately, it's not about the $1 billion making your life better. It's about what you can ultimately use it to, you know, use to serve other people, right?
Yeah, that's correct. Oh, I'm upside down now.
It's there we go. Okay, there we go.
Is this one going?
Yeah.
Is it blinking?
Yeah.
Okay, it's going.
Okay.
But yeah, no, it's, and I don't know. I've talked to Stan about this, where even if, you know, suddenly he had $1 billion, he would just do exactly what he's doing, just at a larger scale, you know. And it's, you know, again, going back to the idea that time is your most valuable asset, it's like there's only so much time you could spend in a day actually doing stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's like you have you and Bill Gates and Warren Buffett and Elon Musk, you know, you all have the same 12 hours to be awake and actually be doing things. You know, whether you're playing video games or spending time with your family or working on a business project or, you know, doing whatever, it's like, you know, the only reason Elon Musk is able to get so much work done is because he has legions of people working for him, actually.
Mm-hmm.
He has an automated process for getting things done, essentially. And, you know, I think that's what the money allows you to do, is it enables you to automate more things. But, yeah, that's pretty much it.
You don't really need money to automate things, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, like you can still, and that's, you know, like if anyone want to take anything away from this conversation, will be, don't wait for that $1 billion to make a change in your life.
Absolutely.
Right, like I did not have the $1 billion before I made a big change in my life.
Right.
Right, like if you want something and you want it enough,
right,
just go and get it. I mean, like legally.
Oh yeah.
Like good stuff, right, go and get it. Like, cool. You can always make it happen. And even if it doesn't happen, you give it a shot. At least you know, oh, I give it my best shot and it didn't happen.
Yeah, well, that fortune cookie, we made lunch the other day at a Chinese restaurant, and the fortune cookie was, it's like better, you know, even to greatly fail is a victory or something, you know?
Yeah, something along that line. I can't remember what it was.
And it's, I don't know, it's like a, like, just because something is hard and risky doesn't mean it's not worth doing, right?
Yeah. Or even better is, even if you fail,
right,
there's something to learn from that.
Yeah.
And it would contribute to your next success. And it doesn't mean that you fail once, next time it's gonna be
successful. It just means every time you fail, you learn something, right. And then that makes you a better or more capable person towards the next one. I mean, in my career, oh, trust me, I fail many times, but not in a big grand scale failure, because I, you know, my whole job is to be a forward thinker, right? Like I manage risk, I prevent things from happening, I look into the future. So by doing that, I'm able to kind of minimize the risk at a certain level, but still there's always, you know, big and small failure along the line.
Right.
Even with Sentient too, right? There's certain ideas that didn't pan out. There's certain ideas that just kind of hit.
Yeah.
But the main lesson here is when you fail, you look and say why did it fail, and then figure out a way to do it better to avoid that, or do it better that you will not fail next time if you try the same idea. So it's always drawing, doing art is the same thing, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
You try to draw this model and then fail, and then you just keep going, and it never turned out. It's not because you were good, I mean, you were a bad artist.
You just didn't fail enough.
Or even better, look around, you have a bad lighting, you wash out everything, there's no dimension. Of course, your drawing won't be dimensional, because the whole thing's washed out. So sometimes, maybe what you need to do is step back, like right here, right? You can see from certain angle, it's just in the van, but then from the other angle, you see outside of the van, you see the whole picture, right? And that's kind of what I do, or what a lot of people do, is you gotta just switch your view and look and say, oh, well, duh, the light was not good. Maybe I changed the lighting, or maybe I changed my angle, and all of a sudden,
it works. Yeah.
And that's why I want people to think is, stop being so hard on yourself and say, I fail.
Right.
Be analytical, look at your situation and say, what contributed to the failure?
Absolutely.
And you'll find out most of the time, it's not you.
Yeah.
I'm not saying like don't take accountability,
right.
But I'm just saying being fair, look at what contributed to the failure.
Yeah.
Not just you.
Right.
Right. I mean, some people are like, oh, the paper is bad, the pencil is bad, the brush is bad. That probably it's you.
Yeah.
But if you put in your work, work hard, do your training, do your practice, you know, and you look and really, sometimes it is the pants, the material, or it could be the model. If the model is always moving and won't stay in the same pose when you try to draw the model, then that's the reason, right? And now the next thing you ask yourself is, well, what am I going to do about it? Like a lot of people, and when I manage the teams, I tell them, don't bring me the complaint, bring me the solution.
Yeah.
If you find something that's not working, just complain to me.
Right.
They'll just kind of buck me.
Yeah.
But if you tell me something's not working and say, hey, maybe we should try this, maybe we should try that, we have some proposals, suggestions, then we are looking for a solution.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, and it's strange that every successful person I've talked to, that's their mindset, is that it's a mindset of failure. Like, it's walking into, you know, a business venture knowing that it's probably going to fail, but going anyway, you know, and knowing that in spite of it, it's probably going to fail, you do it willingly, and you do it with skill and effort and, you know, actual genuine care, you know. And I think a lot of people, they go and do things and it fails once and they're like, oh, this isn't for me, you know. They don't go through the pain of it, and ultimately it's like, you know, I have no doubt that Sentient Academy and VisionX are going to be successful because your approach to failure, you know, it's like, you know.
Oh, we try many things.
Yeah, well, and it's like
a lot of things do not work.
Well, and if you look back, you might admit some of them might have been bad ideas.
You know?
And in hindsight, it's like, oh yeah, of course that wouldn't have worked. You know,
but
that doesn't. You don't know it's not going to work until you try it, right?
Yeah, and sometimes just stop being so stubborn, right? Like, if you try it once, twice, three times, it's not working, just do something else. And
I mean, not
completely do something else, but try, like what earlier I was talking about, try a different approach, try a different angle,
right?
And try again. If that's something that you really want to do, yeah, sure, keep trying. Right. But if it's something that you just don't have passion,
yeah, well, then, and I think it's you know, sorry for interrupting.
No, I'm done.
Well, I think a big part of it is trying, but also trying to get small victories, you know, because when you're doing nothing but trying and getting failures, it really hurts your confidence. For like, I think, you know, the way you make a successful business is you just be very headstrong and, you know, you just keep trying things over and over again and do it well, you know. And, but it's, you know, knowing it's going to take a while, you have to have something else that's like keeping you grounded and keeps you like, you know, the failure is worth it because I have this other thing, you know.
Do you want to know my secret?
Oh yeah, go ahead.
Do I have moments where I wake up or before I go to bed and I'm just like, man, what am I doing?
Yeah, yeah.
Did I just completely failed?
Right.
That always gets you. No matter how big you are, no matter what, like, there are days I'm just like, oh, I can't believe we just accomplished this, a huge milestone. I'm so happy, celebrating, screaming all day.
Right.
And that night, usually it's when that happens, that night, it just hit me really hard. Just feel like a complete loser.
Yeah.
Completely failed.
Right.
I have that all the time. Like, really all the time.
Right.
But how do I get out of that?
Right.
I think that is really my secret is, number one, when you have that moment, just cut it out, just go to bed.
Yeah.
Right? Like, sitting there thinking about it is not going to help.
Yeah.
Go to bed, reset, or if it's during the day, take a power nap. Just let your mind rest.
Yeah.
Reset and get out of that funk. And then when you start over, start finding small success to celebrate.
Yeah, right.
Hey, I wake up in the morning, I don't need to get ready and get in the car and drive to work. Yeah. I'm my own boss.
Right.
Celebrate.
Right.
Oh, it's 9 o'clock. I had a rough night yesterday and I don't want to go down there until 10 o'clock.
Yeah.
Celebrate.
Right.
Right. When you go down there, oh, I'm so grateful that I actually have this job that I get to provide for my family doing what I want to do.
Yeah.
Celebrate.
Right.
Start celebrating all these little things. And then you're gonna start picking yourself up. And of course, care about the people around you.
Yeah.
That work with you. Never look at them as they work for you.
Right.
They all work with you.
Yeah.
Treat people right. And those people tend to come in when you need something.
Yeah.
To pick you up.
Right.
I cannot tell you how many times students random email just completely pick me up.
Yeah.
Especially when I have this thing, I just feel like, oh, I completely failed. Sentient is a fail. What am I doing here? The next day, I will get a student email from Australia, from somewhere, and just say, hey, thank you so much. This is a dream come true. Thank you so much.
Right.
I always wanted to go to art school. I never had a chance. Just wanted to say,
thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
That's it. Like, it's not like giving me a lot of money, nothing. Just that tiny little thank you, and that kept me going.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Right? Like, it's stuff like that, that when someone, I have a mentor, told me, the greatest success happens when you become truly selfless.
Yeah.
And I kind of really, I mean, before, when I was working in corporates, I have to admit, I was the most selfish person in the world.
Yeah.
And I know that.
Right.
Because I was just really all about my job and making whatever. But when I started to be more selfless, it really kind of changed me a lot. You're starting to do things for a better reason and you find more things to celebrate, and that kept me going.
Yeah.
So if you want to like have any secret or whatever, that's probably one thing I can tell. It's not about money, it's not about power, it's not about all the things like, oh, you have how many followers and all that stuff. It's just really true to yourself, true to your friend, true to people around you.
It's mindset, right?
It's always mindset.
No matter whether you're Jeff Bezos or us or...
I'm not envious of Jeff Bezos at all.
If
you look at him, he's kind of miserable.
Yes, he seems very stressed out. But again, it's like the scale of, you know, it's hard to be working on a project and then look at somebody who's worth $180 billion and be like, oh, this is worth it, you know?
Yeah.
But it's like...
No, actually, when you look at that, you'll make you feel like shit, and you'll be like, I don't want to do this again.
Right.
Because you just feel like, I cannot make it. I do that. Look around here, you see all the big houses.
Yeah.
That make me feel like I completely failed.
Right.
And I should just quit right now.
Right.
Really.
Which is...
When you look at people's success, don't do that. Like, that does not help you at all.
No, it doesn't. Well, and it's like a... Part of the reason I'm driving around the country is that it forces me to have perspective.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I can't be sad about, like, I don't have running water, I don't have heating, I don't have a lot of, you know, my don't have a lot of space. This is like 60 square feet to live in, mm-hmm. right? And when I look at my life, I have a lot of things that I can be very dark about. You know,
yeah.
I'm a loser. I live in a van. You know, whatever. But when I go and look at like how most people actually live outside of the United States, it's like I'm extremely privileged. You know, mm-hmm. I have a bed to sleep in every night. I can walk down the street. Like I was walking around your neighborhood, and I was thinking there are places in the country, in the world, that you wouldn't be able to walk down the street because you'd be worried about being arrested mm-hmm. or being murdered or whatever, mm-hmm. you know. And it's like that's a beautiful thing that I take completely for granted, that I have the ability to walk down the street and not even worry about it. And the fact that I ever lose the gratitude and the perspective to not be thankful for that is completely insane, you know.
Yeah.
This
one too. Oh shoot, movie recording has been stopped completely. Okay.
Is it flashing?
Yes.
Sweet.
Yeah, so perspective. And I really admire you for, you know, doing this, because it's funny because before we had kids, my wife and I, and this is before like we made real money, like our jobs are just crappy jobs. And we said we're going to quit our jobs and just live in our little Malibu Max hatchback car.
Yeah.
And just like don't have anything and just live in there and just drive around country. But we didn't have the courage to really go through with it. So the fact that you actually driving around and just visiting people and don't know where you're going tomorrow and just go for it. Like you're going to learn so much, because, you know, that today my wife is actually talking to me about your experience. She's looking at you kind of like, I kind of have a bit of a understanding of what your life was when you first moved here, because I was not driving a van. I was even worse. I did not have a car, so I didn't even get to go anywhere. I was just by myself and basically alone the whole time and just kind of drifting around.
Right.
And you know, you're doing this, and she just kind of like, wow, I can't even imagine what the life would be like, just always on the road, always on your own, and just kind of, you know, like it's a huge challenge.
Right.
And there's a lot that we can all learn from you, just even just taking the courage to seek truth in a way, because you are seeking something. I know you're Absolutely. Looking for something.
Yeah, right? Well, and it's like I have access to go work at big companies. It's not like I couldn't go and do that. And the thing that I'm finding is, like, you know, I mentioned I wanted to talk to you about this. It's like a faith in God or faith in some kind of spirituality or something, where it's like knowing no matter how uncomfortable things are or how bad things get, if you are doing things right and living properly, things will work out in a good way.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not necessarily in like a, you know, if you, you know, follow the Ten Commandments, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
You know, it's more complicated than that. It's like a, if you go out and ask for what you want and make the proper sacrifices, which what I'm doing is like, you know, I'm going out and trying to meet people and have genuine connection with them. And as a result, they're taking me into their homes and feeding me. And like I was telling you, Bryan Mark Taylor, he gave me this tripod and a Strata easel, you know, a couple days ago. And it's like, that's an incredibly, you know, cool gift to give me. It's like, I don't have enough money to buy one because they're expensive. And it's like, he just like, I love what you're doing. Here's this thing. And it's like every time I go out and I, you know, put myself out there in this way, it always works out positively, you know? And the thing that I'm finding is like, whenever I give into fear and anxiety and believing in the worst of myself, things work out worse, right? When I give into the I'm a loser, I'm a, you know, it's kind of like when you start
the negativity just kind of keep dragging you down.
Yeah, like I'm more likely to, like, you know, sit in bed and watch cartoons and eat junk food, you know? And it's like, that's a part of me that exists, right? And every time I give into that part of myself, I become weaker. I become more of, you know,
open for, yeah, like, it become like more sin, vulnerable, right?
I'm more likely to just, like, you know, be an asshole to somebody. I'm more likely, I don't actually
find reasons to be mean to people, right?
Yeah.
And
well, my brain chemistry just isn't good, you know.
Yeah. And also, you know, like, I have a lot of mentors in my life, and I really appreciate a lot of them that really just kind of give me super good tips, and right. you would think, oh, they probably give you tips like this, buy this dog, and do this and do that, and make money. No, really, the stuff they give me is something that is just so valuable that I hold really close to my heart.
Right.
So one of them, he told me, the more you give, the more you get.
Yeah.
And that guy, he's the CFO of big companies.
Yeah.
He's actually in San Francisco right now. Anyways, you would think someone like him wouldn't care about who you are as one of the employees or whatever. But then he would call me up and go to lunch, and then we would chat, and then he would, you know, help me out, give me advice or whatever it is.
Yeah.
And I always tell him, like, hey, Greg, thanks so much. You know, I really appreciate it. And he say, oh, the more you give, the more you get.
Yeah, yeah.
And to me, that means a lot. You know?
Absolutely, yeah. Well, and I think it's, again, that there's like a deeply spiritual element to this stuff where it's like, it sounds ridiculous to go and dedicate your time to helping people when, you know, you could just be helping yourself instead. You know, it's like, I was talking to Bryan about this shit when I had him on. He's like, why would anyone ever paint, right? It's like, it's harder than just going and working at a bank, right? It's harder than starting in it. Like, I think becoming a painter is way harder, like becoming a successful painter is way harder than being worth $10 million.
Mm-hmm.
Way harder, I think.
Mm-hmm.
You know, by going like a traditional route.
In a way, right? Because $10 million or billion dollars, there's a tangible benchmark measurement there for you to say, oh, I have arrived.
Right.
But being a successful painter is like an intangible thing. You never know if you get there. And I think that's why it's so hard. Because if you're running without the finishing line, that's like the worst race to be in.
Well, but I also think it's the best race to be in because it's completely internal validation. It's like, oh, I've been successful. What I'm doing is worth it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, whereas like when you're doing the thing you don't want to do for money, you're like, you know, I don't want to do this, but I'm getting, so you're sacrificing parts of yourself to earn the money, right?
Yeah.
But with the painting, the reason I think it's so tough is because everyone goes through phases of like, I'm a loser. This is a waste of time, you know, it's like, and it's harder and it's more intense because you're selling your ideas, you're selling who you are. And when you like go and put yourself out there in a really vulnerable way and no one cares, it's this, you know, that's hard. You know, that's way harder than just like selling something that somebody needs. Yeah. You know?
At the same time though, that kind of stuff, it's kind of like, and like, if you know me, if you're listening, you know, I say what it's on my mind.
Yeah.
And some people hate me for it, but
I think that's the only way to exist.
But I think you just have to deal with it because you're in the van and you're listening to me, right?
Yeah.
But the thing is, this is what I want to talk, or if there are artists out there listening or bankers or whatever it is, it's easy to see your struggle in your life like this,
right,
through your own lens. And then in Chinese there's a saying, it's like you are like the frog on the bottom of the well.
Yeah.
The sky is only this big.
Right.
So if you're like, oh, you know, art is hard, whatever you just said, you can cut that in so we remember what you said. You need to remember that same thing you're looking at, that same challenge, that same, it's, you're selling yourself, your idea, it's so hard. Every industry, every person is facing the same thing.
Yeah.
Everyone, a banker thinks, oh, I'm wasting my time. Why am I doing this? It's so hard to have someone open a bank account.
Right.
A grocery store person is like, oh, this is ridiculous. Why do I have to pick up these apples again? Why can't you guys just put, you know, like everybody is facing some type of frustration, challenge. Life is hard.
Right.
Life sucks. What am I doing here?
Yeah.
From different scale, different perspective, different meaning, different product, different service, whatever it is. But you gotta start looking at the world as is. Like the world is this big.
Right.
Get out of that little well and just look out, and then you realize, hey, my life is not that bad.
Well, and
you know,
the thing that I've been doing a lot of travel the past 2 years. I spent time in London and Germany and Sweden. I've driven all around the United States. And the thing that I found is that there are universal problems.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone is anxious. Everyone has a boyfriend or girlfriend or kid, you know, something in their life or a boss that they're like, this is something that causes me anxiety.
Yeah.
You know? Whether you're in Alabama or Germany, or I haven't been to Asia yet, but I suspect it's all the same, right? People are people. People are self-conscious and anxious and worried about, you know, yeah. how to feel validated, you know? And the, I had like an existential crisis when I really discovered that, because I realized that it's like, there's no one out there with the answers, right? The answers are something you have to figure out yourself.
Mm-hmm.
You have to go into the world and you have to find out what are the things that are most meaningful to me and worth pursuing,
yeah.
you know? And it's like, that's the reason the van is such an easy decision for me, is because like, I think people are fundamentally most limited by their perspective. And the more you broaden your perspective, the more you're able to see. And if you're able to see more, you're able to like manifest more of what you really want in, yeah. In the world, you know?
Like the example, right? Like, oh, I suck at drawing.
Right.
If you look at it from here, all you see is your drawing, you see is your crappy drawing, and then you don't look out.
Right.
But then if you look around and you realize, oh, I'm drawing a moving horse.
Yeah.
Like, try to draw that.
Right.
Right? So, you just get your head out of your rear end or whatever your head is stuck in. Like,
right.
Look outside of your little scope. Look outside in the world. Go out. Talk to people. Stop looking at your Instagram. Like, go talk to your neighbors. Yeah. Go down to the coffee shop. Talk to the person who's making you a cappuccino.
Right.
Talk to the grocery store, the guy who's, you know, one of a really dear friend in Mesquite when I was down there, is the guy who's in the grocery department in Smith's.
Yeah.
And like I said, I was a selfish person. I never asked him for his name, but I did spend time to talk to him every time I go in.
Yeah.
He takes pride in his work. Like, that is the best produce session I've ever seen in my whole life.
Right.
I love him because he gave me really good produce and makes me happy.
Well, and it's the amount of effort that he put into that is actually more effort than it might take to start a very, very successful company.
Yeah.
You know, it's another surreal thing I've experienced by traveling all around the world, is that there's beauty everywhere. It's like the fact mm-hmm. that we, like, even in Alpine, Utah, right, just one town out of thousands in America, you can go to a grocery store and find beautiful produce sections. You can find beautiful parks and beautiful houses and, you know, whether it's, again, Europe or Asia or wherever else, you find beauty. And it's mm-hmm. like, the cynical part of me would assume that more people should just stop because it's meaningless. But obviously it's not, because you can walk down the street and, you know, we have running water, we have electricity, we have all these things that are, it's like a miracle, right?
Yeah. And right now, by the way, we're on top of a graveyard. So right now we're just like on top of the hill,
right
next to a graveyard, which... to me, it's a nice place to get up here. It's really peaceful, even though one side you see the end of the life and the other side you see the beginning of many, many very overblessed, extremely wealthy people's houses.
Well, I don't know. I think it's the reality is that we're going to die, right?
It is, right?
I think death is something that's like, you know, again, going back to time being your most valuable asset, you only have so much time to live. And, you know, you are going to die, right? It's like...
and you don't know when. That's the thing.
You don't know when.
Money cannot buy you the answer.
Right. I was talking to a friend of mine who, you know, he got, you know, he's retired now and he's done really well in real estate and, you know, in the corporate environments, and he's worth, you know, tens of millions of dollars. But he had cancer when he was, you know, right before he retired, right? Mm-hmm. And it was a super aggressive cancer that would have killed him in 6 weeks if he didn't get it. Mm-hmm. treated. And he was lucky enough to where he was able to get it treated. But it's like, you could go and do something that makes your net worth tens or hundreds or billions of dollars, and you could still get cancer, right? It's like Steve Jobs, right? It's like, no matter how powerful you
are. Did you see that picture before he died? It's extremely sad.
Yeah, well, and it's like, it's like, what the...
he does not look like a person.
Well, and...
But still, compared to a lot of other people who suffer painful diseases and stuff, Steve Jobs is lucky.
Yeah, well, it's like, I think even if you die at 20, you're still lucky. Like, you still have a lot to be thankful for, right?
Yeah.
It's like, no matter who you are, you know, and this is more of a philosophical statement, but even just the fact that you're alive and you can walk around and see, you know, a flower on the side of the street is something to be thankful for.
You know, or even... if you can, the thing is, even if you cannot walk around, even if you cannot see, even if, like, I literally cannot, I'm like blind if I have my glasses off, or I'm short, or I'm not as fast, or I'm not as strong. Like, everybody has some type of defect in your life, in your body, But that's not the point. The point is the fact that you actually here.
Right.
Well, that is something to be thankful for.
And it's like, you know, I think the second I start to become more susceptible to be an asshole and make wrong decisions is the second I start paying attention to the things that I wish I had more of. You mm-hmm. know? It's like, I wish I had more money. I wish women liked me more. I wish I had these friends. I wish I was working on these projects. Every time I'm like that, I become way more, I'm more susceptible to like lie, mm-hmm. you know, lie to a friend, lie to somebody I love, right? And it's like, the thing, again, part of the deal with the van is that it forces me to be modest. It forces mm-hmm. me to like look outside myself and be like, I chose this intentionally. This is something I know that I chose and I can't, you know, I didn't choose to pursue those things. So it's okay mm-hmm. that I don't have those things, you know, or it's okay because this is my path and that's their path. And that's just the way the world works.
Yeah. Or even, you know, like now you've got something to give. You were getting all these interviews and try to, you know, get people to speak, you know, more truthful things and try not to have this mask on and have your status in society because we're in a sketchy band, right? Like, there's nothing here. It's not like we're trying to be here and brag about who we are and what we do and how many followings we have. None of that. It's just really just we're sitting by the graveyard and talk about what is in your heart and what's in my heart and what goes through our heads, right? Like stuff like that gives you a purpose of this trip. Like you're giving back to whoever is going to be listening to this something valuable and really help them to, hopefully they get the message and help them to see that, you know, life is good.
And I feel like I'm not that good of an artist. I mean, I think I'm okay, and I think if I put a lot more time into it, I could become a little bit, I could get to a point to where I could be saying meaningful things with the images that I create. Mm-hmm. But the thing I found is I could actually, for me, I feel a lot more comfortable, and I feel like I am a lot more effective at talking. Mm-hmm. And sharing my ideas this way rather than sharing images and inspiring people this way. And I found that I've been trying to force art. I've been trying to force being an artist because there was something about it that it's like, if I didn't do this, then I'm a failure. You know, if I don't have this level of skill, then it's not worth doing, right?
Yeah.
And that's a version of, you know, trying, it's a version of like the guy at the, you know, whatever corporate company and trying to, you know, being resentful that he doesn't have the CEO job, you know, and treats everyone like shit because of someone checking if that's
still you get it's going
cool.
So you get that kind of stuff all the time, right?
Like, yeah,
and
yeah.
That's the, you know, like when I, oh man, what is dinging? When I moved here, when I started Dixie College, I don't care what they're gonna change the name to right now. That's another topic I want to talk about. There's this other mentor, his name is Carl, he's in career services. He gave us, I guess he gave all freshmen this same lecture. It's amazing. He has cancer.
Yeah.
He's fighting cancer. So he told us just like, day one, I have cancer.
Yeah.
And you can see on people's faces, like really uncomfortable subject. Yeah. You're like, what now?
Yeah.
But then he quickly told us, if anything I'm going to leave behind, I want you guys to know this.
Yeah.
The world is ruined by this idea of not enough.
Right.
I'm not tall enough. I'm not rich enough. I'm not good enough. I'm not enough.
Right.
So we just wrote down not enough on the whiteboard. Really big.
Yeah.
And that stuck with me.
Yeah.
Not enough would destroy you.
Yeah.
Right. Never let those two words get in your head. I mean, they will try so hard. It's like a devil's two words. It's trying to get in your head.
Right.
And you just got to fight it. Instead of not enough, turning around and say, I am good enough.
Right.
I'm tall enough. I'm fast enough. I'm whatever enough. You always have enough in you to fight that fight.
Right.
If you look at it from that perspective, you flip it. And a lot of times, just that mental switch, you just got to flip that switch and say, hey, I am enough.
Yeah.
You may not be good enough an artist, but you are good enough of a person that when I met you at Lightbox, I was chatting with you, and then that was when 2019.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden you show up my driveway, and then we're having this chat right here.
Right.
You are enough. Yeah. For that reason.
Absolutely, you know? And it's like a spirit of thankfulness and a spirit of like, you know, not being afraid of not being exactly where I want to be. You know, mm-hmm. It's like acknowledging that, you know, art is, you know, it's not about trying to be the best. It's not trying to compete. It's about saying things with the things you're trying to do.
You know?
And it's about being honest. And I think the second it becomes about being better than other people, it's no longer art. It's like a competition. It's like a, you know, I think healthy competition is okay. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it, but I think there's something wrong with, you know, only doing it if it means that you're better than other people.
Well, that's another thing you gotta just understand, like, yeah, your art is your voice and all that, but your art is never you.
Yeah.
You're not your art.
Right.
Separate that. Like, sure, you're a good artist, whatever it is. Yeah, you, whatever. You are who you are. It's a person.
Right.
That image, that work is what you create.
Yeah.
But not who you are. I mean, you try to, you know, translate your message and all that stuff. Like, that's fine. But you.
Yeah.
What is in here, that is you.
Right.
Right. And if you see that, you're not going to let your art control who you are and make you say or not say
right.
some things.
Yeah.
Because there's this image, this brand, this persona to protect.
Yeah.
That will just cripple you
yeah.
completely, because you stop living.
Right.
You stop being true to yourself. You may be alone, you may have family, you may have whatever.
Yeah.
You do live in society, you do have people around you.
Right.
So who you are and how you treat people,
yeah.
that is really who you are.
Yeah.
Like your art is out there on the wall, in your garage, in your studio, in someone, some rich guy's house.
Yeah.
That is not part of you. That's not an extension of you.
Yeah.
Right? Like, start focusing on your soul and who you are.
Yeah.
And then work outwards to kind of share that light.
Right.
Because if you are that artist, that great artist, like you say or you believe you are,
yeah.
there's a light in you.
Yeah.
And share that light as a person.
Yeah.
And that, oh, the car is full. Anyways, I think we got good stuff.
Okay, dang. Well, okay, well, these are still recording.
Okay. Here, do you want to do an ending?
Yeah, let's do an ending thing. Yeah, well, okay, so the card on this camera just filled up, so we can no longer get a shot of Keith.
You can, you know, like this link right here.
Yeah.
Click the link, fund the project.
Oh yeah. Well, you can't record. Well,
no. I'm talking to that one.
Okay,
so if you are listening to this,
yeah.
And I hope you put this in. If you want more of this, help out. All right.
Yeah. Well, thank you. That's very kind of you to say. And, if you see that I am on your route and you want to hang out with me,
yes.
Reach out and I'll try and stop by.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, I guess I have no followers yet, so
it doesn't matter.
Talk about Sentient Academy or VisionX or anything.
Keith
is an awesome entrepreneur, and I'm excited to see what he does.
Yeah, just so, you know,
yeah,
fun stuff. Yeah. And you know, you guys, as you can see, I enjoy business talk all the time. I'm nerdy like that. So
yeah,
I mean, if you want to chat or whatever, anytime.
Cool.
Hey, cool. Man. Thanks, man.
Yeah, thank you.
There's no marshmallow today because we don't want to burn the whole
town. So we said before I wanted to do marshmallows, but
dry grass, dry season. We don't do that.
I don't want to serve a fire.
Yeah, so. Cool.
Yeah, cool. Thanks, dude.